So let's summarize what we've covered in this unit. Began by introducing the idea of fractals in a fairly qualitative way. I said fractals are objects that are self-similar. Small parts of the object are similar to the whole. And we looked at several examples, one of which is the picture of the sycamore tree, where we can see that there are branches, off of which are branches, off of which are branches, and the branches all resemble each other. So it's self-similar. And for something to be said to be fractal, it needs to be self-similar over several scales. So branches, off of which are branches, off of which are branches, and maybe branches smaller still. So if that self-similarity is over several scales, we would say that we're working with a fractal. So then we considered some mathematical fractals, like the Sierpinski triangle here, and I introduced the idea of the self-similarity dimension. And here's the key equation, that the number of small copies inside an object is equal to the magnification factor or stretch factor raised to the d power. So for example here, the magnification factor is 2. To go from there to there, we magnify by 2, stretch by 2, and there are 1, 2, 3 smaller shapes. So if we plug that into this formula, we can use logarithms and we get that the dimension is about 1.585. As I mentioned before, this business of seeing small copies and figuring out the magnification factor, it takes a little bit of practice. It's a very visual sort of thing, and so sometimes describing it with words feels really inadequate. So if you're still a little confused on this, don't worry. Keep practicing. There'll be some more practice problems in the homework as well. Okay, so this was the self-similarity dimension. Along the way, we did a quick exponent and log review. This was an optional section, but I just wanted to include it here, maybe as a useful reference. The main thing is that exponentiation is defined to be successive multiplication, and this is a definition for a log, 10 to the log x equals x. And from properties of exponents and the definition of logs, all of these useful properties follow. Okay. So back to dimension, we are working with objects that are between one and two dimensions, or their self-similarity dimension is between one and two. And that's weird, a little uncomfortable. What might that mean? Well, one way to think about it is that they have both one and two dimensional qualities or features or properties. So the the Koch curve has an infinite length, but it's in a finite area. I can box it in a finite area, but the curve between my hands has infinite length. So that it fits in a finite area, that's sort of a 2D type thing, that it has infinite length, maybe that's a 1D type thing. So it's sort of in this in-between thing. It's a shape that has a combination of features. Sierpinski triangle has zero area, but infinite perimeter. So again, these are funny sorts of shapes that have different a combination of different features. Another way to think about dimension, which will be more and more important as the course goes on, and which is, I think, a little bit more concrete, to think in terms of scaling. So if I increase an object's size, if I double it all the lengths this way, this way, this way, if I put it in a photocopier and hit 200%, what happens to the shape? Well, different things happen for shapes of different dimensions. So if we have a sphere, which is three-dimensional, and I stretch it by a factor of 2, it's now 8 times larger, because 2 cubed is 8. We take the scale factor, how much we're increasing it by, and raise it to the dimension. So the dimension tells you how the size of an object changes as it's scaled up. And I put size in here because it might mean different things in different contexts. It could mean volume, area, you could think of it in terms of mass, maybe, amount of ink to draw a shape. But the main thing is, how does the size change as you scale it up? It's determined by the dimension. And there's no reason why a dimension can only be 1, 2, or 3. Nothing wrong with a dimension of 1.5 or 1.6 or anything else. So that's dimension and scaling. I also talked a little bit about this notion of something being scale-free. So if an object is self-similar, we often say that it's scale-free. For example, for the Koch curve, there's no typical size of the bumps, right? It's a line with a bump in it, and on that bump there are bumps, and on that bump there are bumps. They're bumps of all different sizes. In contrast, there is a typical size to a tomato, roughly a pound, sometimes less, sometimes more, but there's a typical size. So if I were taking a picture of some object you hadn't seen before, and I wanted to indicate to you what the size of that object was, if I put a tomato next to that unknown object, you would have an idea what its size was. If I showed you just a segment of the Koch curve, that wouldn't help, because you could be looking at a small piece or a large piece. They all look the same. Another way to think about it is that in a fractal, if you were shrunk, you could not tell. So if you suddenly got scaled down by a factor of 10, and the rest of the world stayed the same, if you lived in a Sierpinski triangle or a fractal, you wouldn't be able to tell, because there are no objects that set a scale or a size. And just a note about self-similarity, it's worth remembering that real fractals, trees and river basins and so on, as opposed to mathematical fractals, real fractals are not self-similar forever. They can't be. There's some lower scale over which the self-similarity stops, and some upper scale too. Nevertheless, fractals are very useful for very useful abstraction for describing objects, just like the pure forms of classical geometry, lines and circles and so on, are also very useful abstractions for describing real objects. So let me say a little bit about the definition of a fractal. And probably the first thing I should say is what's down here, that there's not an airtight, all-purpose, standard definition of a fractal. It's more of a notion, maybe, than an absolutely strict category. But here are some features that fractals have. They're self-similar across many scales, as we've discussed. They're not well described by classical geometry, circles and cubes and spheres and triangles. They have a self-similarity dimension that is larger than the topological dimension. The topological dimension is more or less the intuitive notion of dimension. So the Koch curve, we think, oh, that's a line. So, because it's a line. It's a very bendy line, but it's still a line. So its topological dimension is 1. But as we've seen, its self-similarity dimension is larger than 1. I forget, it's 1.2, 1.3, something like that. So I don't want to go into the topological dimension in much detail, but the main thing is that they have got weird dimensions. Often non-integers are not what you would expect. They're built out of objects that have one dimension, but the actual fractal itself has a different dimension. So this brings us to the end of this unit. In the next unit, we'll look at some additional types of fractals, fractals that have some randomness in them, and so which aren't perfectly symmetric. And I'll also introduce another type of dimension closely related to the self-similarity dimension called the box counting dimension. See you next week.